Hello everyone, this is the third and last part of my Mac Pro 2013 guide, how to disassemble, assemble, clean and upgrade with the latest parts, and practically the last parts you can upgrade it with. So as you can see, I'm cleaning the 12 core CPU, which I named in my first video. Please check out that video. There are links in that video for the tools I'm using right now, that I'm used in the previous videos as well. Cleaning the front of the CPU is important, obviously. Cleaning off the previous thermal paste residue, and also it is important to cleaning the back of the CPU, because they might get a little bit corroded for the previous user's computer. You can buy these CPUs from eBay, for example, and if you are comfortable with it, to buy used parts and you have the experience actually which seller is the best, then go ahead. Just make sure one thing: when you bought the CPU, you test it in another workstation, for example. Make sure it 100% works, because if it doesn't, your Mac Pro will won't boot and you won't know what's causing it. The next step is cleaning off the heatsink from the residue of the previous thermal paste. Obviously it got dried throughout the years. Cleaning it off nicely helps the heat to spread nicely. And yeah, a couple of problems with the CPU. If you're not testing it, for example, the memory channels might not work, which is really, really annoying, or it might not even boot because it can be fried. So these are things you have to consider before start to do this upgrade. The thermal paste, use it liberally. You can see the size of the thermal paste I'm using on each part, on the heatsink and on the CPU, and I like to spread the thermal paste on the CPU by myself, because well, many just do spots and crosses and stuff and let the heat sink spread the thermal paste. But because of this structure of the Mac Pro, I wouldn't trust it to spread it evenly, because the actual heat sink holds the CPU and the CPU bracket under it holds the CPU. So it might not spread the thermal paste evenly. Anyway, it is up to you. I like to spread it nicely, cover the whole surface of the CPU. And yeah, back to the CPU thing. So you make sure that the CPU is 100% working, because this is the most annoying part to replace in the 2013 Mac Pro, and I bet you don't wanna do it again if the Mac Pro doesn't boot. So next step is actually using the alcohol wipes to wipe down my fingers, wipe down the thermal paste from the gloves. It can spare you a lot of time, because if your fingers are dirty with thermal paste, you're gonna smudge everything, and that's not good. I'm talking from experience. Next thing, you grab the CPU board and place the CPU as shown on the video. Find the highlighted corner of the CPU and align it with the cut corner of the CPU socket. Place the CPU in it. Before it, obviously check the socket, there is no dust there or something like that, or bent pin. So you place the CPU in it, make sure it fits well, and then you can start to put on the CPU retainer bracket. But first, I would advise to wipe it down with a little bit of this alcoholic wipe, because there is a slight chance there are old residue remain under the bracket, which can actually damage your CPU if there are too many of those dried residue there, because it can put more pressure than you would like to have. and your socket of the motherboard would like to have. Anyway, when it cleaned, just place it over the CPU, align the holes. You can see there is a hole almost all around, and there is a hole with an open end. The open end one aligns with the smaller part of the upper connecting finger, and the almost round hole aligns with the wider part of the connecting finger on the very top of the board. And then you just put the other retaining bracket on the back, hold the CPU and the bracket with your fingers on the sides, and just rotate 3 or 4 times, maybe 5, and then grab the other screw in a crisscross pattern, and then grab the side of the retainer bracket and push it down, because you have to push it down, align the screw, and then also 4 or 5 rotation. These two screw is enough to hold the CPU in place, and from that point you can just continue to insert the remaining two screws also in crisscross pattern. It's better to just use a 5 times rotation on each first, and for now just leave it like this. You don't have to 100% screw in the CPU retaining bracket for now, because you're gonna align the CPU board with the heatsink, and for that you lay down the heatsink on its back. And you can see, because of my setup, one side would just fell on the side, so it's not good. So just rotate it to the other side, so the top part actually, which you can see, goes next to the power supply, and the bottom part goes away from it. Now you can align the CPU board with the heatsink. You can check the holes to align them, and then start to screw them in. This is the easier part, because these fit really well usually. Just a couple of rotation, 5 or so, but not much more than 5, just to have the first couple of threads grabbing your screw. Crisscross pattern also, as usual, screw in all 4 screws, and then when you're finished, you just grab the whole unit carefully, because it is quite heavy. Although it's a small part, but it's quite heavy all alone because of the full-fledged heatsink. And then you just stand it upright, and then from here you just screw in crisscross pattern all the screws, and you screw in all the way. And when you feel it that it stopped, then you stop as well. You use 3 fingers, or if you are really strong you can use 2, and you're gonna feel when it hits the end. If you feel you over tightened it, just unscrew it a little bit and go ahead again. And when you feel the end of the thread, you just stop there. All 8 screw has to be screwed in all the way, because if you're not doing that, there will be loss of memory channels, for example. There will be extremely slow Mac Pro, which is funny. There can be not working cores, for example. So there are many problems you might encounter if you're not screwed all the screws in properly all the way up until it stops. But don't use your full hand and don't force it, just use 3 fingers. That's the easiest way. And when you feel it stops, then you stop as well. So all 8 goes in all the way. That's how you do it. And of course, next you're gonna reinstall this power supply for the unit, which has these 4 fingers to attach to, and also 2 on the other side of the CPU board. I would suggest that the layout is similar to what I used, how I placed the screws and group them, because it happens that although all the six screw for the power supply, which I'm gonna see soon, are the same or supposed to be identical, but if there is any manufacturing issue with the screw, it might not fit properly with the other hole, so, and that can be quite annoying when you try to place back the power supply and tighten the six screws and it doesn't work. And also, if the screw is not holding properly and they are not aligned as they were by factory, they might held the power supply too far away from the CPU board, and in the end you won't be able to close the Mac Pro case properly. You might have to force it, and that's also gonna force your CPU board, because you're actually gonna pressing on the PSU by forcing the outer case screws in. So make sure when you screw in these six screws, so many screws, anyway, when you tighten these, try to follow the print, the residue marks on these fingers. It's not that hard, you can see it, not on this video probably, but in person you're gonna see it. Try to align the screws as they were previously. That can save you a lot of time, save you the time to disassemble the whole thing and redo this part again. So yeah, this is important also. And when you finish, just make sure all six are tightened properly and go to the next step, which is, when I finish this one, is to placing back the plastic shroud which covers these screws. For that you're gonna use the T6 screwdriver bit, because this is the smallest, obviously, as I mentioned before in my previous video. For the power supply, you used the T8, and for the CPU, in the first part of this video, you used the T10s, but you can find all this information in the disassembly video, so I just repeated it for you. And when this plastic cover is there, you're gonna rotate the unit and reinstall the motherboard, actually, with all the connectors. Couple of words about the memory. Also, you can buy it cheap on eBay, but if you buy it, make sure you have a computer workstation which can handle it and you can test it, because sometimes these Mac Pro are so picky they won't even boot if there is any of the memory modules are faulty. So it's up to you if you want to take this risk. Obviously, I would go with a safety net like that, to having a test unit which is not that picky like these Mac Pro units, and test all the parts before installing it. I just reinstalled the connector for the power supply to the motherboard, and now I'm fixing the motherboard to the heatsink, which is with the T8 Torx 8 screw bit. It's easy, you just tighten it with two or three fingers. Do not overdo it, because it is not necessary. When you finish this one, and before you put back the bottom of the Mac Pro unit, you just check the connecting cables and then align it with the pins and just press it both side, and then it connects properly. You do the same with the other one. I would suggest to use some alcoholic wipes to wipe down these dust particles, because it's not a good thing to have dust in your computer, obviously, on the long run. Although we made sure everything, all connections are clean before we install the CPU and before we install the back the connecting parts of the Mac Pro, but just to make sure there are no remaining dust in it. Then you can place back the bottom part, align it with the PSU and with the screw holes, and then rotate the whole thing so it sits on the bottom, it stands upright, and then you can reinstall the top part, which includes the Wi-Fi connection and the ribbon cable for the ventilator. And so for that you can use the Torx 8 screw. Obviously before that I would suggest to clean the area, why not? And then with the Torx 8, as you're gonna see, you can reinstall the small plastic retainer bracket for the ribbon cable. For the Wi-Fi, you just have to press it down right over the connector and make sure you can move it around and it fits properly. And when you've finished that, you just install the bracket, make sure it is tightened but not too hard, and make sure the Wi-Fi cable is not protruding out of the casing, because that can happen and that can make impossible to screw the case screws when it comes to that, which is coming up in the video soon. Obviously you have to align the screws which you placed, hopefully in two groups. The top one is for the top part of the Mac Pro and the bottom group of screws is for the bottom part of the Mac Pro. You just press it and hold it at the power supply first. On the left side, I would say, start there, left side of the power supply, and then go around and tighten all the screws one by one. Also, you can start to open the memory holder slots just to be prepared for installing the memory modules, which, as I mentioned, you can also buy on eBay, but make sure you test it before you use it. Mac Pros are not particularly happy about faulty parts, and diagnosing faulty parts with a Mac Pro, at least with this one, it's quite intense and hard. It's not like a Dell workstation on an HP, which I suggest to buy a cheap one which you can use to test all the parts before you use it. I think I mentioned this a couple of times by now. Well, it is important, obviously. And of course, if you're not feeling the need or the mood to do this whole upgrade, you can still find a couple of good vendors on eBay who actually do these upgrades for you for quite cheap, I would say. If you add up the parts and all the labor this upgrade involves, then you might be better off selling your old Mac Pro and buying an already upgraded one. I'm gonna leave a link down below with a trusted seller whose track record is 100%. I know him personally and he's the best on the market, I would say. So it's really up to you. If you want it, you can do it, but just follow every step of this video. Also, you can install third-party SSD with the connector I just showed for a second, but I didn't have the third-party SSD to install it, so I just used the original Apple one at this time, which is quite easy, same as I described in the first video, how you remove it. It's practically backwards how you install it. And there you have it, everything is back in place now, just the memory modules left. Obviously you line up your memory module as the socket lines with it, and you place both of the memory module on one side first, and then press down on both end of the memory module until it clicks. And when both are inserted, you just click it into place. On the other side, you repeat. You can see that one side of the memory module has less pins, just as the socket, so align it, press it down on both sides, and then you can click it into place. There you have it, your Mac Pro is ready and done. The memory is now 64 gigs, full speed 1866 megahertz, and also the CPU is the 12 core as mentioned in the initial disassembling video, what was planned here. I'm not gonna leave a link for the parts because you can buy it on eBay and it changes all the time, the prices and the sellers. So you need to find a reliable seller, and as I mentioned many times, you have to test it after you received it, because otherwise you might end up with a bad part and the whole process is going to be a nightmare for you, trust me. I did this several times already. Obviously, as I recommended many times, you should clean everything you can with alcoholic wipes. You can see I'm using the bigger brother of the small wipes. This is also the 70% alcohol wipe, just it's more convenient to use a big one to clean the big parts. And when you did that, you can remove any sticker outside. Unfortunately, this unit had a sticker on it. It's not that bad anyway. You just remove it, and then you can use the alcohol wipes to remove the glue residue of the sticker, which can be quite hard. So use the plastic tool, which you can see on the screen, the blue one, to remove it and not to scratch the casing. It's quite nice, so you don't want to scratch it. And that would be practically all you need to do before you're gonna plug in your unit and you're gonna start to boot up first. For the third party SSD, just a couple of pointers. I'm gonna leave a link in the description below what kind of third party SSD I trust and I use. It is the Intel 660P model. It's last year's model, but it works just fine. It's not as fast as Apple's original one, but it is quite good. And also I'm gonna leave a link for the adapter which you can use it with. They work both properly in these Mac Pros. You can boot from it, although you have to use either Mojave or High Sierra at least. And of course Catalina works just fine. Any other operating system won't recognize these new NVMe SSDs, including the Intel one, what I just suggested. So go with that one. Before you boot up your Mac Pro, as you can see, I plug in everything but the power supply and the power cable, because when you first use the power cable after this upgrade, the CPU replacement, then the Mac Pro gonna start up straight away, and because of that, when you plug the power supply, you want everything already connected, including the keyboard, because you have to use the PROM reset combination, which I'm gonna leave a link in the description, to make sure you clean up your Mac Pro's memory and you make sure you hear the chime. As you can see, it booted up just fine. You can see all the details about the CPU. I did run a Geekbench 3 registered version with 64-bit test, so there is the score for this 12 core, also the memory module and the CPU I used. Make sure you buy these, or the memory can be from any manufacturer but the same model, for the best possible speed. And thanks for watching. If you have any question, just send me a message and see you in the next one.